to sort of deal with water that's collecting in the depressed loading bays. I believe there's area drains in those bays because there's no standing water in them. I couldn't get through all the muck and the vegetation to actually get my eyes on them, but you know, since there was no standing water in those bays, my assumption would be that there is you know, area drains that are ultimately you know, tied into the town system at that point. But beyond that, you know, I would tend to believe that, you know, there are no roof connections at that point. So that being said, I mean, a lot of the stormwater analysis that was done sort of, you know, was based on that assumption that, okay, all the, you know, all the current runoff from the property is sort of getting into the town system and being, you know, outfalling into the Neponset at one location. And, you know, the rest of the analysis and sort of, you know, the applicability of different stormwater standards and how they're, you know, how they're being met were sort of based on that assumption. So, you know, from that perspective, you know, our opinion is that, you know, that stormwater analysis really, there needs to be some more information gathered on what the existing drainage patterns are at that site, and I think a lot more work needs to be done to mitigate what the, you know, what the future drainage patterns will be.
Any questions?
Yeah. On the list of documents in the letter, I have in the record is a peer review from Horsley Witten Group to Chairman Hurley, peer review of the stormwater management stuff. Was this peer review one of the documents that was reviewed by you?
I did look at the peer review, yes.
Okay. And I know Mr. Lynch did.
Okay. Now, I have not reviewed peer review in preparation for this meeting. However, I dare my recollection of the peer review was that the peer review in this letter was fairly favorable to the materials produced by the developer. And what I'm hearing here is that you disagree with the conclusions of the developer and, by extension, the conclusions of the peer review?
Well, I disagree with the assumption of the applicant. Yeah, my understanding was that the peer review consultant was not necessarily looking for new information. Unfortunately, the peer review consultant did not contact myself or the DPW director to sort of you know, get our comments before you know, before anything was submitted to the board. But yeah, as I see it, I am disagreeing with the applicant's submission.
All right, so your big issue, though, is that there is, I'm sorry, I should say the town's big issue on this is that there is no affirmative confirmation that major drainage facilities exist connected to the town's water drain, sewage or wastewater system from this particular property.
Correct.
So how, as a layman, and you're a professional engineer, I assume, or?
I am.
How does one go about confirming the existence of such connections?
Well, it's, yeah, I mean, it is difficult. You know, one option is to you can use remote camera inspection to look at inside the drains to potentially see connections that are coming in. You know, as a DPW and as a town, we go through and we do that routinely, you know, almost on an annual basis to sort of clean out our drains and sort of inspect you know, the condition of drains. Unfortunately, I do not believe we have any video inspection of that particular drain. But that's one way. that's one way that it could be done. You could potentially use dye tests, you know, use high potency, you know, neon dyes to potentially see where things are going.
Has the DPW required similar testing for other residential projects in the town?
Nothing that I could think of offhand, but I think certainly in this case, you know, there's a lot of uncertainty. You know, in other cases, a lot of times, you know where everything's going. You can sort of, you know, determine where stormwater is going, and just in this particular instance, you know, with a building that, you know, the applicant is claiming is, you know, too dangerous to enter, and, you know, obviously by that same standard, the roof, you know, how, I don't know the answer to that question, you know, how you would determine where everything's going.
Well, we've had a lot of construction down in that area over the past couple of years. Are there any records about any rehabilitation of the sewer or stormwater system in the Central Square area?
When we reconstructed the intersection in 2007, we did install some new catch basins, and I from memory, I want to say a few drainage lines in the intersection, but it was mostly replacing existing infrastructure. It wasn't adding new infrastructure.
So there hasn't really been any major additions, alterations, increase of capacity in the area?
No.
Thank you.
So is the concern, John, that you don't know where the water is going, and it's possibly going into the river if it's not going into the town system? Is that?
Well, yeah, the concern is that, you know, the applicant's premise is, you know, all the existing runoff is going and getting into the, you know, the town system. You know, the proposed build-out scenario, they're maintaining that same, you know, that same scenario where all the stormwater is getting into the town system, but by virtue of, you know, installing a few stormwater, you know, I don't think it's Filterra.
Well, we're looking at sort of the standard 2, which is on page 3 of Joe Lynch's letter, which talks about the fact that you have that standard that you're not supposed to have any more runoff than you have existing. And, of course, since the last time anybody's looked at this building, it's been some time ago, I don't think anyone knows where the drainage is going. And the assumption in the report was that the entire site drains, you know, into the municipal storm drainage system, and we don't have any evidence of that. It could be quite going right into the deposit, which wouldn't surprise anybody, considering when the original buildings were built. And everybody considered that to be a normal place to put a drain into an existing river.
Or simply, yeah. You know, sheet runoff flowing over land and not, you know, not getting into a closed system.
But as I said, basically Mr. Lynch and the DPW, you know, have questioned the assumptions that were made by the developer's engineer. And the problem with Horsley and Witten is that their task, apparently, from when I watched the hearing, the tape of the hearing, was that their job was to look and see whether or not the report was adequate, not to go out and do their own hunt for the drain, as I understood their scope of work.
Which is pretty standard. I mean, we only have unlimited
exactly.
funds to send them out
exactly.
And reinvent the wheel.
You've
but,
got a
but,
camera.
But again, just for my own edification, isn't this a CONCOM issue?
Well, it would be something that you would put into, as Mr. Freeman knows from his experience into ZBA hearings, is that you would put a condition, perhaps, into the permit that would talk about, you know, recharging, where the drains are going to be going. You know, there's all kinds of conditions that can go into these comprehensive permits.
Well,
and there may
we,
be.
Why would we do that? Not to be argumentative, but why would we do that? That's not our expertise. That's the expertise of the Conservation Commission. Why wouldn't we, if we were going to do something like that, why wouldn't we simply write a general condition whereby the developer, the applicant, has to comply with the requirements of the Conservation Commission. Why would we want to limit ourselves or the Conservation Commission?
Well, the Conservation Commission can only deal with state requirements, and the ZBA, the purpose of a comprehensive permit, is supposed to be one-stop shopping for a developer. So the developer can come to the ZBA and say, I'm doing this special project, and I need to have waivers and permission from the ZBA for the town's bylaws, because the Conservation Commission can't address that. He can come here for waivers. I don't know whether, he's asked for waivers of town bylaws and things, but the concern we have is that no one seems, it's a big hole. Maybe they do have the answer. Maybe the stormwater is fine, but we don't know that because the assumption is that it's going into the municipal drain.
I mean, but I have a concern with me as a member of the Zoning Board of Appeals. It seems like I'm usurping the authority of a town board that has unique and specific authority and expertise that I frankly don't have.
Mm-hmm.
I have a concern about that. I have a concern about getting it wrong.
Mm-hmm. I see what I said. I see your point, but the project is supposed to be coming before you folks. Unfortunately, that's why you have Horsley and Witten. That's why people have consultants come to these hearings and provide them with the information that you need to make an intelligent and informed decision. But I mean, right now we have this assumption that everything is just hunky dory and going into the drains of the town, and we don't have the answer to that.
What local bylaws apply to these particular issues?
I haven't fully read the local bylaws on that particular issue. But
unless we're mistaken, but we said from the get-go in our application, and I just checked with Chris McCarthy is here, but also Phil Cordero is now here from Allen and Majors. I'll read you what we said in our request for waivers, and we believe it's still correct. We stated that, of course, we will apply with the State Wetlands Protection Act, go to the Conservation Commission. What we said is a waiver is being requested from any requirement to apply to the Milton Conservation Commission under any of the local wetlands related bylaws and regulations, even though the applicant does not believe that waivers from any substantive provisions are needed. So in other words, if this wasn't a 40B, we'd still have to go to the Conservation Commission under the local bylaw. If we're right, we would say, yeah, you're approved because you comply with the conditions. What we're saying is we don't need waivers from the conditions, but as the one-stop shopping, we don't believe we should go to the Conservation Commission under the local bylaw.
So you want us to decide the waiver issues?
Right, but what we're saying is we don't need waivers. If anybody from the Conservation Commission or Kathleen O'Donnell has information to show us that we don't comply with something under the town bylaw, then, we'd have to look into it and discuss it.
But didn't the language you just read to me say that you were asking for a waiver?
A waiver from having to go to them. How it works.
But how can we make that decision without deciding whether or not you need the waivers? So we're right back into the soup of this. I didn't really appreciate that that's what you had done.
Well,
I thought this was purely a CONCOM issue, and we could frankly punt it to the CONCOM. Because Frank is right. We don't have expertise in this, but in any event, but if you've asked to waive the local wetland bylaws, or for us to determine that you're in compliance with all the local wetland bylaws, then we have to get down into all this.
Well, I think that there's still a significant distinction. You can get verification from, be it the Conservation Commission or the agent or whatever, as to what the local bylaws are. We can do that too if you would like, and show why we're saying we don't need a waiver from it. So, I don't consider that the same as having to grant waivers. We've stated it from the get-go the way
it
is.
We have to analyze the stuff, though. I mean, we don't have to grant the waivers, but we have to look at them and decide whether or not you're right. I mean, we don't. As great a guy as you are, Peter, we're not just going to take your word for it. We have to make that determination based on some evidence that's been presented to us, and I'm not sure that you've done that yet.
Well, that's fine. I mean, we can certainly do that. I will have to go back and look at the peer review, Horsley and Witt, and see how they commented on it. I honestly don't recall.
I don't know if Phil or Chris can address that at the moment.
Well, they, you know, in the Horsley Witten review letter, they strictly addressed the stormwater standards under the Wetlands Protection Act as being, you know, the state.
They weren't looking at the local bylaw, and I have no idea whether the local bylaw is different or more stringent or whatever.
You know, from our perspective, as we look at it, the local bylaw with regard to the riverfront redevelopment aligns with the State Wetlands Protection Act with regard to riverfront redevelopment. So our application, while being done at the state level, would follow in line with what they would want at the local level. You know, but again, as Peter mentioned, I would let, you know, the conservation agent or the commission, you know, make that statement for your benefit, too.
Make what statement?
Well, if we were to apply under the local bylaw, there would be nothing different about this application. It's just the fact that we're applying at the state level and making that clear. We haven't changed the fundamental engineering that's being presented to you.
I'm still not sure I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, well.
Well, I mean, I, we have no problem talking further with the CONCOM. It's only inferential, but the chairman of the Conservation Commission made many relevant remarks, as we know. He didn't raise any concern about waivers from local bylaws. Again, I'm not saying that's the last word, but I believe that's because he's in sync with the way we've summarized it. So from my viewpoint,
I don't think I don't think that was a misunderstanding at all. I think he was saying that he understands from a 30B that 40B that he can't go to the local stuff.
That's fine. I only said it surmise. I didn't say that we weren't going to check with him. But the other point is, tying it with what Phil just said, is if we're correct that the local bylaw lines up with basically the same as the state, then yes, the Conservation Commission may not agree that we meet the state standards. But if that's the case, then they've effectively agreed that we don't meet the local standards. And so if you granted a waiver from just the jurisdiction that we don't have to apply to them, no harm done, because the Conservation Commission would be determining based on the same standards that we don't meet the state, and we'd have to go through the DEP process. So,
but you're going to have to convince us that the local bylaws not more stringent than that.
Absolutely. That's right? Fine.
And
that's
we
fine.
Haven't, we've, there's been nothing presented to us on that subject whatsoever.
Okay. That's fine. You know, we'll certainly do that.
And then what if we decide that it is more stringent? Just take the worst case scenario.
Then we have to convince you that a substantive waiver is appropriate. Agreed.
And then we're right back, and we're into the very issues that I've been trying to avoid studiously.
Well, except that we don't disagree that we have to comply with, you know, what we still feel are basically the same standards. So we're not trying to get around complying with cleanup.
We're talking in a vacuum here, because we have no idea what the local bylaw says, because no one's given it to us, and no one's opined or explained to us why it is that it's not more stringent.
I understand. Again, I don't know if the conservation agent looked at the application. As you know, you sent out, that's what 40B.
I'll be shocked if the Conservation Commission agent comes in here and tells us that it's not more stringent
grant the waivers. So far, process-wise, we hadn't received any input back, even though all boards are asked to respond. That's all. And so I'm not saying that they've, you know, that speak now or forever hold your peace.
Right.
Obviously, there's still an opportunity, and we respect that.
Okay. So at the next hearing, you need to address this issue one way or another.
Sure.
Because we have no idea where it is at the moment. Anyone else from the town, Kathleen, that you want to present tonight?
No, thank you.
It's 10 o'clock.
I'm sorry. I just asked a question, Mr. Happ. How involved the...
Go ahead.
No, we're not. How involved that in-camera or remote camera inspection and the dye testing is and the time period it takes?
Not particularly involved. You know, in some cases, we could do it in a matter of days. You know, if we have a specific issue that we need to look at, you know, typically not for drainage, but more for, you know, sewage, or, you know, if we have a damaged pipe or something, or a sewer backup, you know, we could typically, you know, hire a vendor and get into a pipe right away if we need to.
Well, what about for drainage? So you're saying drainage is different from that?
No, I'm just saying that typically we wouldn't have that sort of need to have an urgent type of inspection done on drainage, but.
I mean, you're essentially looking for infiltration into the.
Well, right. Ultimately, as currently submitted, the, you know, some of the stormwater standards aren't being met. You know, specifically standard two. If not all of the existing stormwater is getting into the town's system currently, and under the proposed project. It will be going to the town system, then you know, they're exceeding the pre-development runoff rates. Standard three, they're not meeting standard three either, in that presumably there is some infiltration happening on the site now, either through the, you know, the infiltration chambers or potentially, you know, sheeting over land and infiltrating. They're not meeting standard three either.
Kathleen, it would be helpful for us, speaking mm-hmm. just myself now, yep. at the next hearing, Peter's going to present what he's going to present, but if there's somebody from the town that can come in here and tell us their view on whether the local bylaw is more stringent and whether it's mm-hmm. an issue yeah, for yeah. us that we have to deal with.
Well, it seems to me that, I mean, I know that when applications get filed by developers, they always have that kind of blanket, like, give me whatever waiver I think I might need, even if I don't know what it is. I mean,
that's not what this is.
No. I'm not talking about you in particular. I'm just saying that's not an unusual request that goes before a board, that you say, I don't, you know, sort of a blanket catch-all thing is sort of standard. So it seems to me that that we can talk to the Conservation Commission, but I think the developer should be doing some looking at what they need, if they do need any waivers from the local conservation bylaw, the local, and put it in their list. And if they don't, then we won't issue a waiver of any of the conservation rules and regulations, and then they'll just be back at the Conservation Commission for the whole thing.
Okay, that's fine.
Don't you think that makes, I mean?
It makes sense.
That's a fair point, because I think the requests for waivers under the zoning bylaw were relatively specific, but the one for the Conservation Commission, which I just looked at, was just general.
But
the distinction is, we weren't asking for a blanket waiver. Well, I agree with, it's our burden and we'll do it. We will compare the local bylaw, and presumably we're right, and if we're wrong, shame on us, but we'll deal with it. But yeah, we'll show you what we believe is that it is no more stringent. So we're on the same page on that.
Well, as I said, Peter, your last paragraph says that a waiver is being requested for any requirement to apply to the Milton Conservation Commission under any of the local wetlands, even though you don't think that you need those waivers. Well, it's sort of back to your...
No, it's just a procedural thing.
If we're
correct that the local wetlands bylaw is no more stringent, then what we're saying is, grant us a waiver from applying under the local wetlands bylaw to the Conservation Commission, because whatever they do under the State Wetlands Protection Act, in their opinion, based on their hearings, would be the same as what they would do with the local. And why put us to the burden of having to obtain a second permit?
Well, if you're having to go to them anyway, under the three permits that you've already filed, then wouldn't it make sense to have the ZBA just not issue any waivers of the wetlands protection?
No, because, again, my expectation is that we would not need a substantive waiver from a specific local bylaw, which is the same as like a standard, or a standard such as the standards and requirements of the DEP regulations. But, you know, if we're correct with what I'm saying, then the burden potentially, and I'm not in any way suggesting that the Conservation Commission would be unreasonable, but even if they're being reasonable, there can be differences. And why put us to the burden of another appeal and process of a local bylaw if it's the same as the state, and then we have a state process with DEP appeals and all of that to court if necessary? That's all I'm saying. That's what 40B is for. We don't have to go through another hoop if there's nothing substantive involved. If it is substantive, then the board either would become comfortable based on our evidence and peer review and all of that and grant a waiver, or if they're not, then we're stuck with that.
Well, then why wouldn't you come back to us the next time? I'll talk to the conservation agent, but why wouldn't you be taking a look at the local bylaws to see whether or not you need any specific waivers?
That's what I just said. We agreed that we would do it. We stated it. We weren't brushing anything under the rug, and I agree it hadn't come up until now. But I agree. We will go through it and make sure and show you that it is no more stringent, or if it is, do we need a waiver? I agree.
Okay.
I'm just saying that I'm still saying I think it's appropriate if we show that to you and you agree that that's correct, that I still think it's appropriate to receive a waiver from having to apply to the CONGOM. That's all.
I have to think about that, but okay, I understand what you're saying. Anyone else that you want to have testify tonight? Anyone here that would like to testify tonight who may not be able to come back again? There being no, okay, sure. Come forward, please, sit. Can you just let him sit there if you want?
Sure, absolutely.
Could you just give us your name and address, and I'm happy to hear from you.
I'll be a lot less technical.
Okay.
My name is Keith Mills. I reside at 39 Hawthorne Road in Milton. I am the owner of Esprit de Vin at 25 Central Ave. You know, you guys have seen me a lot lately.
We have.
Just want to let you know.
Not for the right reasons, though.
under that note, I wish I would see you more. just a couple of comments. Again, we'd like to see some development there. Not against any of the development. We just, you know, I'd like to see it smaller. I'd like to see more parking. I took a quick look at the traffic study, and I'm not sure if it means anything or not, but the only time that they do the traffic studies are on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. Maybe it'd be nice to do a traffic study on a Wednesday or Thursday or Friday or Saturday, sometime with a little bit more high volume. So I look at this and I say, you know, we pick some days that, just happen to be not really busy in the neighborhood. And I think it's busier on Fridays and Saturdays there. I don't understand on Elliott Street, you know, where the parking is now and where the egress is going to be and how we're not going to lose any spaces there. I guess, you know, I think according to American standards, the average size car is somewhere between 14 and 15 feet long. When you throw in, you know, maybe a foot or so, and I don't have the standards anymore I used to, I don't see how we, you know, how it gets any better. To me, it seems like it's worse. It kind of, I can't see exactly, but it seems like where the egress is where my side door is, where I get all my deliveries 3 days a week, 4 days a week. And I, for me personally, that finds it to be difficult to try to get deliveries from, all my delivery people when there's a, you know, a driveway there. And again, you know, as selfish as it may seem, you know, I'm really trying hard to, you know, have the business and to run it. Anecdotally, you know, Fridays and Saturdays, you know, it's hard to find a place to park there. And it seems to be getting more difficult and more difficult with the development that's going there. And again, that I'm not against development. I just don't know where everybody's going to park. And I'm concerned about that because, you know, all our little businesses, you know, our destination stores, you know, we don't have the ability to have a parking lot where people can come and park and shop. And as I've mentioned before, you know, if people drive by and they don't find a place to park, they don't come back, and, you know, that's an unrealized sales, and that's business that we're lost. You know, I really think if they, you know, if we could do a smaller vision of a building, something with more parking, then I think it could be a win-win for everybody. I'm just concerned now, by the way that I'm looking at now, you know, there in fact, you know, becomes less parking, more cars, more traffic, and then less business for us in the area. And, you know, I can't be any more succinct than that. And, you know, I really hope, you know, you hear what I'm saying out there. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm inclined to close this session of the public hearing for tonight. You guys in agreement?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Should we talk about dates?
Sure.
I don't think we can.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I just wanted to make a couple of quick statements that I didn't get in while the town engineer was up here, if you'll indulge me, just to put them on the record. We testified at the September 30th hearing that we didn't have, you know, the formal connections into the municipal system because we didn't have direct access to the building. So his statement is true and remains true, and it's what we testified to, that, you know, we need to do our homework on that to verify all of that. But the result remains the same in that the stormwater flow, wherever it's going, whether it's going towards the tracks, towards Elliott Street, towards Central Ave, ultimately it actually all flows to the river. We need to control it by mandate that the pre-development flows at the property line are not increased post-development condition. And we testified with Horsley Witten here agreeing to that by the mere reduction of impervious surface that's out there, we have an immediate reduction in our pre to post-development flows. So we immediately can meet that standard, regardless, again, of where it goes. Now, our discussion went on to state how we needed to meet some of the other stormwater standards because it was a riverfront project and a redevelopment project, and we talked at great length, I won't bore you with all those technical details again, of how we came back with ways to improve the stormwater to the best of our ability that's out there. And, you know, I just wanted to make that statement because, you know, the town engineer said we don't meet standard 2 and we don't meet standard 3, yet expressly at our last hearing, we said, yes, we do, and, you know, Horsley Witten agreed with that. And that standard, again, is independent of local bylaw. It's, you know, it's implemented at the state level, so we can push that issue aside, you know, that we have the independent third party that was in agreement, you know, with the testimony that, and the calculations that we put forth. So I just wanted to put that consideration out there. You know, we'll certainly put together the report under the local wetlands bylaw and, you know, testify to that as well. But I just wanted to respond to those direct points that the town engineer had brought up. We will work with them on the final formal connection. And quite frankly, I think the preferred path is to connect everything to the municipal system for exactly the same reason that the town engineer said that you don't want direct flow going into the river. You don't want it uncontrolled. So let's control it. Let's route it through the system the best way we can. And that's what we sought to do and still seek to do.
Okay.
Thanks. Thank you. Thanks for that indulgence.
Yep.
What a nice Friday night meeting.
Not going to conflict with the Christmas party. It's amazing.
I'm sorry?
I'm going. From Wednesday the 19th to Sunday the 23rd.
Okay. All right, it's a Thanksgiving.
We did try.
Be back in?
Yeah.
Tuesday the 25th?
Tuesday the 25th is fine.
How about Tuesday the 25th of November? Does that give you enough time to do what you have to do?
Mostly with you guys.
Tuesday the 25th.
November 25th.
My wife, yeah. My wife can pick up the kids at the airport.
No, I'll be free.
Is that okay with you guys? I'm available.
Fine.
I mean, I'm just conscious of the time constraints.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that.
And maybe we need another hearing, but I'd like to leave us enough time to do that. Yeah. So if we could do the 25th, that would be helpful.
Yeah, that works. Okay, good. Thank you. Tuesday.
Okay, so Tuesday, November 25th, 7:30, same place, Mary, right here?
Yep. Does the board have further traffic concerns? Would you like me to come back?
I don't think you need to come back, Jennifer, but if I have a sudden change of mind, I'll let you know, all right?
Before you close, just one other thing. I think I did it officially. You had asked at the end of the last hearing for my sample town regulatory agreement related to the perpetuity.
Yes. I think you sent it to us.
I did submit it, and I believe I submitted it to Mary as well.
the town, a sample town regulatory agreement. I'll just do it again. It doesn't matter, but since you mentioned things that were submitted.
Yeah, I have.
Yeah, okay.
Could you send it to me so I can send it to Alex Whiteside, because he has a question about it?
Yeah, sure. I can forward it to you.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
I've already told him it's
yeah.
standard form, but...
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so we'll see you all on the 25th of November.
Thank you very much.
7:30.
Okay. Yeah. I like to leave here with nothing.
Did you have a chance to look?